principles of the angle of attack. If the indicated airspeed remains constant and an angle of attack increases, lift will increase. Now down on the bottom of the screen, we have our pilot's lift formula in a graphical version. So we can see highlighted in blue is the indicated airspeed. We can also see highlighted in red is the angle of attack. Now we can also see that as the airspeed decreases towards the top right hand corner of the square, the angle of attack starts to increase. Now if we travel down to the left hand side of the square, indicated airspeed has increased and the angle of attack has decreased. What this is saying is that as our indicated airspeed increases, we're now generating lift as a result of airspeed as opposed to angle of attack. If the aircraft is now flying slower, we still need to produce the same amount of lift to maintain level flight. And the only way to do that is to increase the angle of attack. If we look at the three aerofoils above our rectangle, we have an aerofoil at 4 degrees angle of attack, 8 degrees angle of attack, and 12 degrees angle of attack. We can see at 4 degrees that our aircraft is flying in level flight. And it's probably in the middle between of our squares. It's producing lift as a result of airspeed, and it's producing lift as a result of angle of attack. However, if we now start to reduce our indicated airspeed, we still want to maintain level flight. So in order to do that, as our speed decreases, we need to increase the angle of attack of the aerofoil to still produce the same amount of lift. And the further we slow down, the greater the angle of attack is going to have to be to generate the same amount of lift. And that's pictured on the 12 degrees angle of attack. You can see we have quite a large angle of attack, which means we're flying quite slowly. So we need to produce a lot of lift to maintain level flight. Principles of the axis of movement. Now, unlike a car where we're just operating in a 2D area, we can really only go forwards and backwards and left and right. In an aeroplane, we can climb, we can descend, we can roll left, roll right, your left, your right. So we need to understand how the aircraft moves and on what axis the aircraft moves on. So we have three dimensions in which we're going to move about the center of gravity. We have pitch, roll, and yaw. Now pitch is on the lateral axis, and we can see if you put a rod through the wings, the aircraft will pitch about the lateral axis. Now we have roll, and roll is where we put a rod straight through the middle of the aircraft, similar to a rotisserie chicken or a spit. That aircraft will now roll about the longitudinal axis. Now we have yaw, which is where if we put a rod straight through the cockpit, through the center of pressure, down through the center of gravity to the middle of the earth, this is our normal axis. So yaw is controlled with the rudders. If you increase the right rudder, the aircraft will yaw to the right, and if you increase the left rudder, the aircraft will yaw to the left. Principles and the primary effect of the elevator. So this mass brief is talking about our effects of controls. So we need to understand what our control column does when we either want to pitch or descend. Now with the elevator, with the control column, we can either pull it back and that will raise the nose, or push it forwards and that will lower the nose. This will move the aircraft about the lateral axis. Now you can see here with the first picture of our 172 flying in straight and level flight, we're in cruise, the elevator is level. If we apply some back pressure or pull back on the control column, you can see that the elevator is now deflected in an upwards position. On that aerofoil, we have the leading edge and we've now changed the trailing edge. And in doing that, we've changed the camber, we've increased the curvature of the aerofoil, and when we increase the camber, we generate more lift. We've also changed the chord line. We're still on the leading edge and still to the trailing edge, but it's created a larger angle. When we generate a larger angle, we're going to produce more lift. And what that lift now does is it's going to push the elevator or the tailplane down. And as we push that tailplane down, the nose of the aircraft will pitch up. We've just pitched up, now we want to pitch down. And we can see that the chord line has now changed from going from the top to the bottom of the aerofoil. So we now changed the angle of attack, we've changed the camber, we've changed the surface area of the wing, we're generating more lift via pushing forwards on the control column. As we push forwards on that, the lift force is going to push from underneath the elevator and push it up, which in turn will now lower the nose of the aircraft and put us into a descent. The ailerons. Now, the ailerons, as we said from our definitions, are located on the outboard sections of the wing and allow the aircraft to go left or right. Now, the way we do this is by rolling the control column to the right. And as we do that, it's on the left aileron will go down and the right aileron will go up. Now, as the left aileron goes down, we're going to be changing the chord line, we're going to be changing the angle of attack. And as you know, when we change the chord line to the relative airflow and the angle of attack, we're going to generate more lift. And as we generate more lift, that will then push the wing up and roll it over to the right. Now, similarly, when we turn to the left, we're going to roll the ailerons or the control column to the left. The right wing aileron will be deflected down and the left aileron will be deflected up. So again, we're changing the chord line, we're changing the angle of attack, and we're generating more lift. That lifting force will then get the aircraft to roll to the left. Principles and the primary effect of rudder. So rudder allows the aircraft to yaw to the left of the right, and we control yaw through our feet on the rudder pedals. So if we increase the pressure on the left rudder by pushing our foot forwards, that's going to get the aircraft to yaw to the left. The way it yaws to the left is by changing the chord line, so our rudder will now deflect out like so. So the rudder will be pointing to the left. It will then create a lift force acting sideways, which pushes the tail out to the right as a result in the changing of the chord line, and the nose will then yaw to the left. Similarly, if we go to the right, with our right foot pushing in on the right rudder pedal, we're now going to deflect the rudder the opposite direction. That will then change the chord line. We'll then get a lifting force which now acts out to the left of the aircraft, and it will then get the nose of the aircraft to yaw to the right. Principles. Now, as we had primary effects of our controls, we also have some secondary effects of our controls as well. The first one we're going to look at is the secondary effect of elevator. Now, when we apply our back pressure and raise the nose of the aircraft to climb, if we don't change the power setting, as we climb, the airspeed is going to decrease. A good example to think of our speed slowing down is when you drive a car up a hill. If you don't push your foot on the accelerator, the car will slow down. Now, as we're descending and we don't change the power, the aircraft will start to accelerate. Like if you have a truck on top of a hill and you push it down with no accelerator, the speed will continually pick up. Exactly the same thing happens in our aircraft. If we push forwards on our control column, the aircraft will start to descend, and as a result, the secondary effect is an increase in airspeed. Principles. The secondary effect of ailerons. Now, the primary effect of aileron was roll. Now we're going to look at the secondary effect of aileron, which is yaw. So once the aircraft is established in a roll, a side slip occurs resulting in the yaw, and the aircraft will then pitch down. Now, the way this occurs is the relative airflow, or the aircraft, always wants to align itself with the relative airflow through the dorsal fin. As we roll the aircraft, we're now changing our direction, and the relative airflow will change the direction on the way it hits the aircraft. As a result, the aircraft now wants to yaw into the relative airflow. So as we roll the aircraft, there's a change in relative airflow which will hit the rearward section of the empennage. The aircraft will then yaw into the relative airflow, and as we yaw into the relative airflow, the nose will then start to pitch down. The aircraft will then continue to roll even more, it will then yaw even more, and it will then continue to pitch nose down even more. Principles, the secondary effect of rudder. Now, as the aircraft yaws, one wing is going to travel faster than the other. As a result, the increase in indicated airspeed will generate more lift on the outer wing, which will then get the aircraft to roll. As a result, roll is the secondary effect of yaw. So as you can see in the diagram below, our aircraft is turning to the left. The inboard section of the wing is traveling a lesser distance compared to the outboard wing. And in order for that wing to travel the same amount of distance, it has to increase its airspeed. Now, if we go back to our pilot's lift formula of lift is proportional to angle of attack times indicated airspeed, the angle of attack is kept constant. The only thing that's changing is we're now increasing the airspeed of the outer wing, and as a result, the increase in airspeed will produce greater increase of lift. And as a result of that increase in lift on the right wing, it will cause the aircraft to now roll to the left.